It's exceedingly speculative. It's highly risky. But it's what SSI was meant to do. So we're going to just jump in. In-space propulsion is kind of like the weather. Everybody talks about it and nobody does anything about it. But I believe it actually, fortunately, might be easier to do something about advanced propulsion, exotic propulsion, than to actually do something about the weather. So that's part of the premise behind our third enterprise, which we call the Exotic Propulsion Initiative. When fully funded, this project is going to support concepts for truly revolutionary propulsion systems. We expect lots of false starts and failures, because if you're not failing, fundamentally, you're not trying hard enough. So in this, we distinguish ourselves from the principal other backer of exotic propulsion ideas, the U.S. government. No, again, no offense to our hosts. NIAC is one of the bright spots as far as I'm concerned. So we hope to be a patient supporter and to tolerate setbacks. And we don't mind if we're laughed at, because fundamentally, all great ideas, you know, people start by laughing at them. That doesn't necessarily mean they're all going to be successful. That's a corollary, right? So we hope that our work will lead to a breakthrough, but there's no way I can tell you when or if. So this initiative kicked off with a modest contribution that also included the assignment of royalties on a book that's relevant that I'm going to mention in a moment. But first I want to talk about the intriguing, though naturally controversial, bit of experimental effort that prompted us to start this work now. The late Arthur Clark provided me with my initial motivation and guidance. Writing in Profiles of the Future in 1960, he made, I love this comment, irreverent comment, that he never found a physicist who could give him a straight answer to the question, what is inertia? Well, we think we may have. Professor Jim Woodward is in the audience. Jim, if you wave, he's sitting in the back, came up just for this talk. Professor Woodward took his guidance relating to inertia from some of the great minds of the last two centuries, Ernst Mach, Albert Einstein, and Dennis Sciama, among others. Mach's principle is at the root of Jim's work, supported by theoretical understanding developed by Sciama, who was Dirac's student, Hoyle's colleague, and Hawking's professor. So these are not lightweights. All right. They're giants from back in the day when physics actually produced testable theory. I have only a few physicist friends, and they'll let me get away with that one. So can I say with certainty that Jim's interpretation of Mach's principle is correct? Of course not. I'm a rocket engineer, some may say a rocket plumber, but not a physicist. When someone mentions fermions or bosons, I have to stop and think which are which. But the late editor of Scientific American, Philip Morrison, offered a phrase which I think describes my view on Professor Woodward's work, the ring of truth. Morrison argued, rather interestingly for a scientist and a skeptic, that one should go with one's intuition when judging theories that might be viewed as outside the mainstream. Now, Morrison was also a card-carrying member of the skeptic fraternity, so likely he would not approve of my usurpation of his opinion. Nevertheless, I think, or in this case I'll say I believe, it is valid. Keep in mind one thing as I go through my next few slides. This is not just theory, it is grounded in experiment. In my world, experiment trumps theory, and for the sake of our collective futures, may that always be so. Yeah, I might be tempted to add political theory as well as scientific theory, but like my good friend and colleague Pete Warden, that would just get me in trouble. Fortunately, no one could fire me. So I'm going to try to describe this idea, an engineer describing a physics idea, in rather broad brush strokes. If you want a more detailed explanation, talk to Jim. That's why he's here today rather than back in the lab gathering more data. So first off, Mach effect propulsion is based on peer-reviewed, technically credible physics. That's my view of it. Mach effects are transient variation in rest masses of objects that simultaneously, and that's a key part of this, experience both acceleration and internal energy changes. These effects are predicted by standard physics, where Mach's principle applies, as discussed in a bunch of journal papers that Jim and others have written, and his book, which I said I would mention, called Making Starships and Stargates, The Science of Interstellar Transport and Absurdly Benign Wormholes, published by Springer Verilek last year. You can actually go to ssi.org if you want and order it. So Mach's principle has a number of interpretations of the general relativity community. Professor Woodward and his colleague Professor Heidi Fern at Cal State Fullerton hold a particular view that inertial reaction forces are produced by the gravitational action of the chiefly distant matter in the universe. They argue that the WMAP survey, which has done the recent measurement of spatial flatness in the universe, means that general relativity should actually effectively predicts inertial effects arise from this interaction of the whole mass of the universe on a local object. So now if we produce a fluctuating mass in an object, we can, at least in principle, use it to produce a stationary force on that same object. This process gives a propulsive force without having to expel propellant. We simply push on the object whose mass is fluctuating when it is more massive, and we pull back when it is less massive. The reaction forces during the two parts of this cycle will not be the same due to the mass fluctuation. A time average net force will be produced. Now, this seems like a violation of conservation of momentum. Depends on how big you draw your box. If the Lorentz invariance, or some people call it the covariance, of the theory guarantees that no conservation, the Lorentz invariance guarantees that no conservation law is in fact broken, local conservation momentum is conserved. It's conserved by the momentum in the flux of the gravity field of the object as it exchanges with the distant matter in the universe. Right. Just need to draw your box big enough. This particular flux, this gravito-inertial flux, is orders of magnitude, tens of orders of magnitude, larger than that which is customarily associated with gravity waves. Okay. This is because electromagnetic forces are at the root of it. They are what are involved in inertial forces by this interpretation, not minuscule gravity quadrupole radiation. So these transient effects are Newtonian order. That is, they're surprisingly large. Okay. And they produce thrust. So, of course, the question is, how do you produce a fluctuating mass in an object? Well, the obvious way is actually subject a capacitor to a large rapid voltage fluctuation. Capacitors store energy in their dielectric lattice stresses as they're polarized. Ions in this lattice are accelerated by the changing electric field. If the amplitude of the energy density variation and its first and second time derivatives are large enough, detectable mass fluctuation should result. Note that simply charging and discharging a capacitor will not produce mass fluctuations. Okay, we're not saying that. They must at the same time be subjected to large bulk acceleration. So a clever solution is the use of electromechanical materials to make the capacitors. This way, while energy is being stored in the device, a mechanical acceleration of the device is produced by both first-order piezoelectric effects and second-order electrostrictive effect. So I told you there was experiment. You just saw the experimental devices. Extensive experimental work has already been performed over the past 10 years to demonstrate the existence of the Mach effect. The thrust produced are in the order of a few tens of micronewtons. These are very, very small forces. But they've been produced in stacks of PZT, that is lead zirconium titanate material. These crystals are operating at 30 kilohertz with a reactive power of about 200 watts applied to it, most of which shows up as heat. With a little optimization, we expect the thrust can be increased by an order of magnitude or more. That's still a pretty small force, but you're not throwing away any mass. Right. So ultimately, we believe the thrust could go much, much higher, but that's for the realm of speculation at this point in time. We're currently in the midst of working with other piezoelectric materials to enhance this effect. And we have an intern, in fact, coming in this summer to work it. This is a very, very low budget activity. Okay. A key future consideration will also be the removal of waste heat. You can see the magenta line in this this graph shows the device heats up with each cycle. So what you're seeing is the application of power to the system and a thrust trace that is that lags it by a few milliseconds. And then you can see the temperature go up, relax for 5 seconds, and then once again go up. So these devices cannot be run for any protracted period of time. This is very, very early days as far as we're concerned. Okay, so far I've confined my remarks to what Jim calls the impulse engine term of his Mach effects equation. There's another term which leads us into rather deep water indeed. This is what he calls the wormhole term. And rather speculatively, it could lead to the creation of stable and traversable wormholes. Professor John Kramer noted some intriguing possibilities regarding wormhole transportation in his utterly compelling talk, one of the most interesting I've ever heard, at last year's Starship Symposium at UCSD in La Jolla. So I was delighted to see that he's on your scientific advisory board, and everyone should listen to him give that presentation. Jim's book also goes into a lot of detail about the possibilities and the technical challenges. Suffice to say, a lot more work is required in this field, and it may all come to naught. We're not guaranteeing anything. We're just going to try. But that work demands funding. So here's the plug. We're happy to undertake collaborations and replications, and if everybody in this room signed up to be an SSI member, we would double our budget associated with this project. So that SSI.org. Okay, so in closing, let me relate a short personal story. I first met Arthur Clarke, Sir Arthur, at his club in London about 10 years after I read Profiles of the Future. I read it when I was 10, so I met him when I was 20. And I quoted him from memory a passage in his book that he wrote about interstellar travel being limited by the speed of light in normal space. Let me repeat it for you. When you're next out of doors on a summer's night, turn your head towards the zenith. There, shining above you, will be the brightest star of the northern skies, Vega of Lyra. 26 years away at the speed of light, near enough the point of no return for us short-lived humans. Hold it back. For no man will ever turn homewards from beyond Vega to greet those he knew and loved on Earth. I was 20. With the brashness of youth, I said I intended to prove him wrong. I intended to be the man to prove him wrong. That was 40 years ago. With the wisdom of age, he replied, "I wish you would." That was Arthur. 4 long decades later, the truth is, I won't be that man. But Professor Woodward, his colleagues, and his successors might well be, but only if they're given a chance to answer the big questions. So I'm out of time. So all the discussion of amazing wormhole stuff needs to be left for another day. Or you can, again, just go to SSI.org and order a copy of Jim's book, which makes fascinating reading. You'll be doing yourself and our Exotic Propulsion Initiative a favor, as the royalties are nearly 100% applied to our work. And we also welcome all of you to participate as SSI senior associates as well, since that's our primary means of support. Thank you very much.